Greetings. On behalf of Dr. Inês Stamp and myself, I'd like to begin by thanking the university for inviting us to participate in this conference. Dr. Stamp is the coordinator of the Revealed Memories Reference Center in Brazil, which is our main team, our main subject here. This presentation was made by the two of us, but we agreed that I will be the one doing the talking part. To begin with, I'd like to recall very briefly some important facts about the trajectory of the Brazilian democracy in the second half of the 20th century, which was a quite troubled time for us in Brazil. We had a civil war, many coup attempts, and at least two successful coup d'etats, a very hot century for Brazil. In particular, I would like to highlight that from 1964 to 1985, Brazil was under a dictatorship that lasted for no less than 21 years. So a very long dictatorship. In a very quick way, we can characterize this dictatorship as a political experience very similar to other dictatorial experiences in Latin America during the second half of the 20th century. For instance, it was a dictatorship that was born out of a military coup and had the decisive participation of the National Armed Forces of Brazil in its operation, as can tell us the fact that during the time, all the presidents were generals from the army. Tanks on the streets were a trend in Latin America during the second half of the 20th century, and in Brazil, it was no different. We can also point out the support of large national and transnational companies like the types of Volkswagen, Chrysler, Ford, General Motors, Toyota, Kodak, Caterpillar, and Johnson & Johnson, among others that supported the dictatorship in Brazil. And finally, we cannot forget the strong support coming from the United States government in the context of the Cold War against the Soviet Union. During this period, the Brazilian dictatorship established lasting directions and administrative procedures for the performance, for the way the Brazilian state acts and do its decisions. In the same way, it strictly delimited the actions of the Brazilian society, formed cadres in the academy, and established procedures for the bureaucracy and for our country security force, like our police. It marks are mostly visible in large construction projects like dams and huge factories, but also in less ostensible elements, such as the conformation of the Brazilian public service in the highly concentrated spectrum of the Brazilian media and in the way the Brazilian state manages the information that it's produced and accumulated. This subject, this theme, is very important to us, given the permanence in Brazil of public debates about the legacies of the regime established by the coup d'etat of 1964. And also given the huge number of documents currently held in custody by the National Archives of Brazil, which has more than 13 million pages of textual documents about the military dictatorship from 1964 to 1985. In addition to other types of documents like films, photos, maps, and others. We cannot really understate the importance for Brazil and maybe for Latin America of this documentation. This is a unique set of documents in South America, both for its enormous length and also for its content, which allow us a glimpse on the behavior of the immense machine of internal surveillance and recession put into operation by the Brazilian military dictatorship. Considering the volume, the huge size of this documentation, as well as its thematic plurality, there are many subjects that you can study in this documentation. We do not intend to present here each documental found archival found individually considered, but rather to briefly analyze the general characteristics of this documentation. This is a documentation about repression, about vigilance, about the ways a dictatorship controls the civil society in a huge country like Brazil. One good question before we start is, where did this documentation come from? As a general rule, the documents produced by extinct federal agents from the period of 1964 to 1985 are currently located in the National Archives of Brazil. The National Archives is an agency linked to the Minister of Justice here in Brazil of the Federal Executive Branch. Regarding the dictatorship documents, however, this was only put in effect in 2005 during the first Lula da Silva government. At that point, the documentation was held by the Brazilian Intelligence Agency, that is the Brazilian CIA today, and was by order of the President Lula transferred by federal decree to the National Archives of Brazil. It's an important fact, but because even today, after so many years, after all, we're talking about 2005, there is still a lot of resentment and grudge in the military about this decision and about other decisions, like the one to create the National Truth Commission that was created in the Dilma Rousseff government in 2011. This set of documents include, among others, the collections of the SNI, that was the National Information Service, the CIA of the dictatorship, the ESNIC, as the National School of Information, which operated within the scope of the SNI, the CGI, the General Investigation Commission, that was the body in charge of investigating allegations of corruption during the period of the dictatorship, and the Information Division of Federal Police and General Staff of the Armed Forces, in addition to dozens of collections referring to sectoral bodies of intelligence systems, such as the DSI, the Security Information Divisions of the Ministers, and the ASIs, that was the Security and Information Advisors that operated within the public agencies, including public universities, hospitals, and others. We will not do here a deeper characterization of these organs, but in general, this system of intelligence can be understood by its similarities and differences with the North American system in some sense. The central agency was the SNI, and it was really very similar to the CIA in its scope, in its operation, in its mission, but with one big difference. The CIA is supposed, at least supposed, to work collecting information outside the United States, while the SNI was focused from the start, from the beginning, in collecting information inside Brazil. As the creator of the SNI, General Goberido Couto Silva, once said, the SNI was a window to look inside Brazil. So it's a window to look inside Brazil. As I said before, the size of these collections are huge. However, these collections are also notable or famous in Brazil for its gaps, for the missing papers, especially with regards to documents that may lead to the clarification of serious human rights violations that occurred during the period of the dictatorship, such as torture, murder, and forced disappearance. We, of course, cannot characterize these gaps or missings as coincidence or accidents. That's not what this is. As the French historian Le Goff once said, more than partial records of times, archival documents are a selection, not random, of traces of the past. Traces of the past. In this sense, subjective criteria and political conveniences guide not only their production and accumulation, but also their destruction and concealment. In this way, the adoption of specific memory policies to face the historical legacy of systematic violations of human rights in such Brazil aims not only to guarantee the understanding of what happened to understand the past, but also to reinforce in Brazil the collective understanding that strategies are still needed to combat this violence, to fight this violence today, in the present time. Because these violations in present times are still part of the Brazilian social reality. And for this purpose, the federal government of Brazil created in 2009, during the Lula da Silva government, the Revered Memories Reference Center. Its full name, its official name, is Center for Political Struggles in Brazil, 1965-1985, Revered Memories. It emerged from the understanding that the memory is a public good, that it is at the basis of the process of building a country's social, political, and cultural identity. Officially, it was created by the Civil House of the President of the Republic on May 13 of 2009. It is administered by the National Archives of Brazil, which is the central body of the Archive Document Management System, SIGA, that is a huge system of archival reference here in Brazil, and part of the Minister of Justice structure. The memories, Revered Memories, was very important because it was possible after its creation in a pioneering way in the Brazilian archival art to establish partnerships between individuals throughout a network of data and information exchange. This network is called the National Network of Cooperation and Archival Information, Revered Memories, and counts today members from 2022, 178 partners, entities, and institutions throughout Brazil and even abroad. In the US, in USA, for instance, we are partners of the Brown University in its program Open the Archives. It's a program that held some documentation about Brazil-US relations during the dictatorship period. Also recognizing the great importance of the documentation that has not been held by the National Archives, agreements were signed by the central government of Brazil and the state-level governments that hold collections from the period, seeking to integrate these documents into a unified database. In recognition of the importance of this initiative, in May of 2011, the project was approved by the International Advisory Committee of the Memory of the World Program, the MOU from the UNESCO. In that sense, the documentation of the Brazilian military dictatorship is somehow international heritage good. One very important thing in the operation of the Revered Memories Reference Center is to integrate the archival collections held by different institutions. One of the main tools of integration is our database available on our web page. You can Google us if you would like to visit our web page. The web page offers information on public and private collections, referring to not only documents, but also books, videos, and other multimedia elements. Digitalization and description of the documents were carried out in accordance with international preservation standards. It's also important to note that all documents that were digitalized, that digital files have optical character recognition, OCR, making it possible to quickly research for names and expressions, which is extremely positive considering the volume of the documentation. Currently, there are more than 60 million pages of documents available to access in the Revered Memories database since 2019. The Revered Memories also produced in the period dozens of scientific and technical events related to these documentations. Some events have even a international scope and address the issue of the archives of Latin American dictatorships, with the participation of experts from Europe, United States, and the other Latin American countries, of course. Despite the importance of these initiatives mentioned here, it is necessary to recognize that this cannot be understood as a triumphal story of releasing documents for public consultation. Revered members faced many difficulties and pressures throughout its history. The first, I will point out two difficulties here. The first one that I would like to mention is the, an administrative difficulty, an administrative matter. Brazil is a continental-sized country. It's a very big country. And it's also a federation, like the United States. Although the National Archives of Brazil is a relatively well-equipped institution with a qualified technical staff, the same does not apply necessarily to the state-level archives institutions, In this sense, the International Network for Cooperation and Archive Information suffers from the beginning from somehow a sort of asymmetry of its members, which makes it very challenging to carry out projects in partnership, even with the technical and financial support of the National Archives of Brazil. The second and last difficult that, challenge that I like to point out is a political one. As once said Marx and Engels, the ideas of the ruling class are in each time the ruling of the ideas. That is, the class that has the material force, that has the money, is at the same time its ruling intellectual force. If you extrapolate Marx and Engels' statement, it's possible to affirm to say that the memory of an era of a time, it's also the memory of the ruling class, hence the importance of fighting for it. Even if the military of Brazil was never truly cooperative in the search for missing documents, today the situation is much more complex and worse. The resumption of reactionary political agendas in the national political scenario shows that the present times puts revered members and all other institutions and public and private bodies that work with this kind of matter in the struggle, in great challenge because of the gravity and the proportion of the reactionary movement, perhaps not yet fully revealed for us. This may be a somber final remark, but we can also say in a positive note that we and many others in Brazil will still work and struggle to locate and to open these documents to public access. I'd like to thank you all for your time and to say that we are very happy to be here. And if you want to get in touch, you can Google us. You will find the Memórias Reveladas, the Revealed Memories. And we would be very happy to help you with your research or just to talk about these matters. Thank you again, my name and the name of my colleague, Dr. Inês Stampa. Bye.